Clarko says, bye-bye to the Apple Isle with a huge win over the Suns of the West down south. Can the Dogs still secure a second chance? A powerful performance of 19 goals straight puts an end to Carlton's finals hopes once and for all as a club champion plays his 300th and last game. And no Dusty, no Dynasty for the Tigers as the Giant Killers turn the dimmer switch down on Richmond's finals hopes. The Swans held off a rampaging ruse, handing North their first wooden spoon in almost 50 years. Swan star Will Hayward joins us live as they prepare for September. The Classy Cats, they clawed away a win after a slow start at Cadinia Park, locking in a finals double chance. While up north, Charlie was all revved up, the Lions mauling the Magpies as Brisbane find another gear at the right time. And what about this? Olympic bronze medalist Harry Garside will join us live. He'll preview the D's round for reach game today. Damo has all the latest COVID news. Brownie's quiz is ready to go. Billy's checking his list. Lordo's deep dive is ready to roll. And the volcano is bubbling away nicely. It's all coming up on the all-powerful, the all-conquering Sunday Footy Show!
Yes, a very good morning and welcome to this edition of the Sunday Footy Show. I tell you what, hasn't Billy got some pull round here? Billy said, righto, that's enough from Canberra. Let's go.
We had enough of slow-mo.
Yeah.
Let's go, mate.
Let's go, mate.
He was in slow-mo today.
Yeah.
That was good. He was to the nation, but we want the footy show on. That's what we wanted, Tone.
Well, quite clearly, I don't know who you rang, but you put a phone call through.
Eddie.
And next, he rang Eddie.
Yeah.
Really?
Mm.
Most powerful host at Nine.
Politics, too, he's getting into.
Sorry, T, I was only kidding.
I don't appreciate the sarcasm. All righty, let's head over the border. And he's still in exile, I'm afraid, Kane Corns, but he's here in spirit and also via satellite. G'day, Kane.
G'day, TJ. Hey, usually we look at some concerning vision from the AFL rounds, but I've got some concerning vision that happened during the week where one of our panel members absolutely disgraced himself. So stick around for that in Court Mire coming up shortly.
Lord.
Well, that narrows it down to about six.
Not in the park. It's not me, you. It's one of these two.
It's one of these two.
G'day, Tane. Great to be with you. Let's get on with a good show, eh?
Yeah, exactly. And also, Damien Barrett's here. How are you, Damo?
I'm not TJ, and I'm just going to be venturing into Billy Brownless's animal fact space in what caught my eye today, too.
So, oh, really?
A funny stuff preview of what may or may not work later on.
I know that Damien's up and about because, inexplicably, I backed my car into the car park this morning just as him and his muscle machine came. And tell me if I'm wrong here. You stopped in front of my car and you revved your machine three times.
Yeah, and as I did it the first time, I thought, I really hope that's TJ.
But why did you do it?
Just to maybe start the day in a different way.
He's a rev head.
Up and about.
You're a rev head, aren't you?
No, I'm not, actually.
I still don't even know why you're driving that big
muscle
car.
Back, yeah.
How shocked was the makeup artist this morning when we told her what car you drive? They thought you were in the Mr. Bean.
Like a whole
In fact, the laughter was, she couldn't stop laughing. But anyway, Matthew Lloyd's here as well. After what was a testy week on Classified.
Yeah, it was a testy week. I think it's that time of year we all get a bit testy and we want the finals to come around, the home and away rounds to be over, but I'm a bit nervous because I've been told that what caught my eye could be all about me this week. So,
It's not all about you, Matthew.
What a shame. It's
but
not
can a... I? Well, I'll just give you a little taste of what might be coming up a little later on. Your football captain at school, St. Bernard's, Hoags?
Hoags, yeah.
Hoags. Bit of a knockabout bloke.
Yeah, knockabout bloke.
Yeah. Would he have a few stories on you?
He might have a few, yeah.
Okay. Well, here's a taste.
Oh, no.
This is the first instalment. This is what we call a tease.
A tease. And we're at the Crowbar on King Street. At the Crowbar on King Street, it was early morning. You were on the Vodka Cruisers.
There you go. So you're on the Vodka Cruisers.
What's happened to Hoax?
I think he got caught in that bean nest.
Just got the wisdom teeth out, Hoax. Come on, Hoax.
He sort of like, that was at his bar at home, which is sort of like a monument to himself by the looks of it.
So you're on the Breezers, were you in King Street?
Yeah, we were together. Yeah. I don't know where the story's going next. But
well, I'll tell you where the story's going. It's going into what caught my eye, and Hoax is going to give us the second instalment. So thanks to a mutual friend of ours, Fitzy, for organising all this.
Not happy, but anyway.
No, not happy. And if you had friends, we'd have dirt on you.
Yes. What I am sensing, though, as I look at Matthew Lloyd, is that a fresh rinse?
Yep.
Because that looks a lot darker than what it was last week.
I am ready. ready to go finals time, Brownie.
He's having a look at it. It's dark, isn't it?
I don't know what he's about. He's losing his, and I'm just
trying to... No, I'm not. That's a fresh, something for men, isn't it?
That's as good as you got, is it?
Well, I think you've hit a nerve.
Hey, the Giants are coming too. Leon Cameron, they're going well. Just some really good form coming in.
Around 22.
Hang on, you can't do that to Matthew and then try and be Mr. Credibility. Oh, hang on.
The Giants, 39 points. They are on fire at the moment. The Hawks, see, they've got a good record in Tasmania. And the Cats just got over the line, Corns against the Saints.
Speaking of coming, Port Adelaide have won 10 out of their last 12. They're flying. They smashed Carlton. Brisbane also smashed Collingwood. And Sydney did enough against North Melbourne.
Well, this leaves the ladder in this stage. Geelong at the top end of the ladder. Port Adelaide, Melbourne, the Western Bulldogs. Brisbane can still go into the top four with the Dogs next week. Sydney down to the bottom. West Coast Eagles, that is a massive game. The Bombers just outside Richmond, St Kilda. Richmond, you'd think, are done. So too the Saints and Fremantle. But it still can change. So let's have a look at how it can change. And here are the games next week.
No. I'd probably stick to the rundown, mate. Yeah.
Right. Okay, so the latter two pages, and then if.
That's a verbal one.
Okay. Well, do you like me to verbal it as well?
Verbal
it. Okay.
So, can I just say, you're far better off in the production meetings following the rundown as opposed to reading the Harris Scarf catalogue in the Herald.
It's good on you, TJ. So if the Eagles and the Suns win, top eight is locked away. GWS and Eagles play final. So that's about what you need to know. I thought that was a board coming up, but it wasn't.
I know you're a little nervous this morning. We all are, because it's very early in the piece to have a volcano. Oh, no. But that is exactly what's coming up right now. An early instalment of the volcano, Kano.
Yeah, just got to get the people up. Because I heard Damo on the radio yesterday say very likely that the pre-finals bye will be scrapped. It should be scrapped forever. So there's two things that we never need to see again following this season. One's the stand rule. Got to go. Don't want to see it again. The second is the pre-finals bye. The advantage that it doesn't give the teams that finish top four, particularly this year if they don't get that home ground advantage, what's the incentive to finish top four? So scrap the bye, have it in the lead up to the grand final, celebrate it, get the teams fresh and ready to go for a big grand final. We don't need the bye before the finals start, and I hope we never, ever see it again.
What about during the finals, Kane? Because I know Damo's going to talk about this at length.
Well, I'm OK with one prior to the grand final, similar to what they do in the Super Bowl. You can have all the award season, then you can get, you know, if a player's got a concussion, he may be able to come back and get the best availability for the grand final, but we don't need it in the lead up to the finals. And Port Adelaide and teams that are flying into the finals, it just sets it up beautifully for them.
Damo, it would be worse to actually have the bye before the grand final. It's going to be a very long 2 weeks.
Look, TJ, it's on the discussion list of topics, and it got really strong as the week rolled in. So the date of the grand final is September 25, Saturday, September 25. The best I can ascertain these conversations to be, that will stay. Again, things can change. We need to say that every single time we talk about COVID possibilities. But if we work backwards from that, there's a thought, and there's two thoughts on this, whether you get the first 2 weeks of finals away or even the first 3 weeks of finals away without the bye, coming straight in off the round 23 season, and then to reset. So if it's to reset after the second week, after the semi-finals, there's four teams left. They may be then deciding getting all four teams into the one area they want to play the grand final, be it Melbourne, be it Perth, be it Adelaide, or to then play the prelim finals and just have two teams left and then have the reset to get into that potential state and that situation. So that's the way those conversations were going during the course of this week. And as we now have three matches remaining of round 22 and a full rack of round 23 still to come, that's where it's at.
Dave, I want to ask you, so at the moment Geelong are on top. Yep. So first week of the final, Port Adelaide are second. Will they get to play the finals in this? So is it about money and getting it to a venue where we can get fans, or integrity of where they finish?
The money has to come into it, at least in the conversation since Lotto. The competition has been draining $5 million a week now for the best part of 12 weeks. That was on budgetary figures, given the requirements now to relocate so many people and to play games. So that's part of the conversation. In terms of the first week, again, these conversations during the week would have the first week of finals played where they're meant to be played. Now, that would be in front of no crowds in Melbourne, if that was the case.
And it would have to be Cordinia Park, surely.
Well, again, that conversation will start again.
Port Adelaide would get a home final.
That's my understanding, Brad. But to just use the current quarantining allowances to get the first week away.
But, Damo, if Port Adelaide was to be given a home final, as Port Adelaide should, and there are no crowds in Melbourne, then Geelong has to play at Cordinia Park.
I would think so, TJ, given that scenario, given they've earned the right for the home final in that state. But, again, we have to say this again. That was the conversation as of Friday night, yeah. Saturday morning. Mm. Again, it could change. It could all change again. But I still feel it could be the post, the prelim final, having that week off to get the two grand final teams potentially into WA, potentially elsewhere, or just to potentially reset Melbourne for the possibility of a crowd.
Just on that, I should reference to Melbourne win today, they'll go back to the top of the ladder. And how's their fans going if they don't get to see their club in the first week of the finals as well?
Hey, one side not figuring in the finals, and if you watched them yesterday, you'd think to yourself, why not? I'm talking about Hawthorn, of course.
Yeah, they were really good, and they've been good for 4 or 5 weeks. They beat the Bulldogs yesterday. There's Alistair Clarkson there. And it hasn't been yesterday's performance that surprised. I mean, it was plus 16 inside 50s they had yesterday, so it wasn't as if they just got over the line or they scraped through with the Bulldogs getting more inside 50s. They smashed the Bulldogs around the stoppages, plus 17 in contested possessions, plus 16 inside 50s. They've now won 3 in a row, and you go back 2 weeks before that, they drew with the Demons. So their form in the last 5 weeks, bar a loss to Adelaide, has been outstanding. It's been a good month for the Hawks. It's been a good month for that man there, Alistair Clarkson, and they are on the uptrend at the moment.
I just wonder, though, they when it was first announced that he was going to coach again next year, there was, they got belted by the Dockers. And I reckon since they've said Clarko is going to move on and Mitchell will be the coach, see, the performance has been better and stronger. So what I'm suggesting is the clarity for the players may be what they were looking for in this. And it's considering the players they've got out there, Hawthorn, it was a great win yesterday. They've beaten Brisbane and also the Western Bulldogs in the last few weeks with Gunston, Bruce, Warple, O'Meara, Day, Sicily. So,
are you excited about next year for Hawthorn now, knowing that 5 weeks ago everyone was worried about Hawthorn, where they're going? Are you?
I was equally as worried as everyone else, whereas now I'm thinking it's not as bad as we all thought.
Well, assuming Sam Mitchell can coach.
That's right. I still can't believe the best coach in the competition's got one more week to go at that club.
And that one more week, Bill, is against Richmond, the reigning premier that will most unlikely not be in the finals this year. So that's the final game, maybe 17 season, 4 premiership winning coaches, Hawthorn Footy Club, and he's going out with a great degree of pride.
In the meantime, I'm just really proud of this group of players and what they've been able to do in the last little while to show our supporters that despite what's unfolded over the last 4 or 5 weeks, there's a really strong future for our footy club. Yeah, I've been really, really proud to be able to help shape the lives and careers of some pretty special people who've been involved in this club for a long period of time.
So, Kane, can I ask you this? Having not seen that match in its entirety yesterday, did Hawthorn play brilliant football or were the Dogs off?
Bit of both, TJ. Hawthorn were terrific. From a Dogs perspective, I was a bit concerned about a few things I saw, just failing to do the fundamentals of the game. So this here from Bailey Smith, this just has to go across the line. You've got to know the rules. You can rush that. He doesn't. There's a goal. Oh, I could have highlighted 5 or 6 easy goals that it was the Dogs' fault. The lack of effort here, this has to be cut off. Melbourne in finals cut that off. That kick inside to Nash just opens up the whole ground. They allowed Hawthorn to take 96 uncontested marks. And then once again, I mean, that's a simple uncontested mark inside 50. There was a few brain fades. Easton Wood, that's just got to go over the boundary line. You won't get pinged for that. Comes back in board, not sure what he was thinking. And there's a goal against. And then backline stoppage, easy position to defend. Wingard runs around onto his left, the most dangerous person at that stoppage. Kicks an easy goal. So they've lost to Essendon last week. Now Hawthorn kicking 5 goals. They got some worries.
They got smashing the clearances the last 2 weeks, Kane. Tim English, before he had that concussion issue and was out for a couple of weeks, his form forward was outstanding. I think 46% of the time they went to him, they scored. Now he's gone back into the ruck. They don't have that second backup ruckman at the moment. They've got injury concerns. How do you see that centre square playing out come finals?
Yeah, you know what? I wouldn't mind seeing Dunkley forward. He's played that role again. Now, he's not a prolific goal kicker, but can Josh Dunkley be the Josh Bruce? And I know it's a bit extreme, but to have that second target forward, their efficiency going inside 50 with their personnel is an issue, which was highlighted by 5 goals yesterday. And they have enough midfield cover to cover Dunkley. They need a second target forward. Could Josh Dunkley be the unlikely one throughout the finals?
The worry for me is that Peter Wright got them last week. Kaczynski played like Wayne Carey for periods yesterday without having, kicking a huge bag. So
been the worry.
Yeah, their midfield's getting smashed and now their defence looks vulnerable at the same time, TJ.
Kane, did you get some snow over there yesterday, did you?
Wow.
Was that?
There was an avalanche in the second half.
I was at the Adelaide Oval yesterday and Carlton for the first half was like, where's this come from with all their players out? And then there was an avalanche, TJ. I mean, look at the second half. Avalanche, Lanch or Lanch, whatever it is, you clowns over there. There's my boy Rosie. He was good yesterday. But this was extraordinary. Now, no Cripps, no Williams, no Mackay. We know all the names that were out. But for Port Adelaide, it's exactly what they need. They're starting to get the runs in the legs of Gray and Fantasia and Butters. Those have missed some footy. Ken Hinckley has them positioned beautifully.
And was there avalanche over there? Because it's a bit frosty, they tell me, don't they? Mm. With Kane and a few others over there.
Media person.
Yeah.
What's happening there, Bill?
Well, just heard.
That's nothing new, is it?
No, but it might have got, has it gone to the next level now, Kane? Or?
No, I don't think so, TJ. I'm not sure who's feeding you this information.
I don't know, but we'll back you in every time. You know that.
No, I'm not on this one.
Hey, Adam Sard gave away a free kick behind the football yesterday. I'm not sure whether he got dragged for this or not, but you see him on the bench just after that. Gives away, and the game's over there, 90-odd points down at this point. But there was a little bit of remonstration. Now, he was the high recruit, high-priced signing, and he's very disappointed either with himself or his actions or the way the club's going. And you can see that footy means a lot to guys. So being consoled there on the bench, Adam Sard. So it's been a tough year for the Blues and they're looking for the end.
Emotions were also running high after the game with Mark Murphy. It was his 300th game and also final game. And there he is being chaired off. Now, look, I have heard some people question why would you not chair off Marcus?
But 300 games, exactly. Well done to Cripps there and Eddie Curnow. 300 games, club captain, of course. He won a couple of best and fairest at the club. All Australian.
He was a great player.
Exactly, yeah. Right. So yes. I think Bryce Gibbs was out there too, was in Adelaide this game, of course. So well done to Mark there. And that's fair enough, a little carry off. And look, they'd be disappointed with the result. But that also, he's just about to say to Gibber there, that also is his last game of AFL footy.
Yeah, as I just mentioned.
I wasn't listening.
No.
It may be the second last game for David Teague as coach too, given it was the worst performance of his in the 3 years he's had as coach. And post-match, you can tell that the toll is getting to him. It's a football sad situation which is unfolding here. And he's still, though, maintaining a degree of faith.
Oh, look, it doesn't help. I understand that. In terms of the pattern of behaviour, that's our first really big loss. Yeah, timing's not great, but in terms of where we've been and the way the guys approached it at the start, I thought we cracked in. I thought our pressure and our ball use, and we used it well early. It may not help, but again, I think it was one game. I think over the year we've been pretty competitive, but we've got some growth, and that's where we're at the moment.
So David Teague post-match there. I tell you, people have been critical of David Teague for his laconic demeanour, if you like, and sort of sending the same message. But his media conference through the week on the Wednesday, I think it was, he was fantastic. And maybe that was the sort of grunt that he needed.
What,
to sort
of fire in the belly? Or?
Well, no, he was just putting out a plea, almost challenging the board to reappoint him. And for him to actually do that on the day that the board was being presented with that independent review, I thought said a lot about him. So, look, yes, he'll probably lose his job, but I tell you what, the way he's gone about it, I think he'll walk out with his head high.
He hasn't deviated, has he, from the very first game he played? And the club hasn't supported him, at board level. I mean, to call the review the way they did, you know that the uncertainty that creates, the moment it's announced, and then you get people coming in from outside your club asking you questions about your job. Yeah. That has created a landscape and a backdrop to what's happened in the second half of the season.
Where are we at?
Well,
right now, with the review.
Their plan, always from the outset, was to not act on it, or at least not determine how to act on the review, until post-round 23. Now, whether the timeline changes as a result of those 19 goals being kicked in a row by Port Adelaide yesterday, whether people at the club panic, whether David Teague wants to know an answer prior to that period and point in time. Yep. So, as we speak, he will coach round 23, but things, as we've seen this year, can change.
You were scathing during the week on your AFL platform on the Carlton review, in a sense, the board, the presidents and all those sorts of things. Do you think David Teague has been affected by that? Do you think he should be have sympathy for what he's had to deal with?
I would have thought so, given that they committed to him, rightly or wrongly, for the next year in a contractual sense. Mm. You've got a board and an incoming president in Luke Sayers who's been on the board already for 9 years. Now, that period of time takes in the Brett Ratten sacking, into the Mick Malthouse sacking, into the Brendan Bolton sacking, into the David Teague appointment. And here we are with Michael Judishay leaving the board as president. Luke Say's coming in. No support at all for David Teague. Look, I think he was the wrong appointment to begin with. I need to flag that as part of this conversation. That's my opinion on that at the time. But at the same time, when they do appoint him, when they do sign him for 2022 and they don't give him any support, I think it's on their heads as much as the football department they're actually reviewing themselves. I think they should review their own board.
All right.
They haven't had a footy director. Chris Judd hasn't been there since last year, and Jeannie Pratt hasn't been doing too much, despite being re-elected at the start of this year as well.
More in the agenda, possibly. But let's turn our attention to Geelong and St Kilda. And this was a terrific game. It really was. And what turned it around in the end was just a terrific piece of play that we'll see a little later on from Patrick Dangerfield.
That's right. But the Saints are on fire. They kicked the first five goals. And you see a lot of goals kicked in that corner. That's the hardest corner at this ground to kick goals. Maxie King, he looked like Matty Lloyd, to be honest. He was marking everything. And when he gets those... here it is here. Lovely mark by Danger late in the game to kick that and get the Cats home. But Jack Steele was on fire in the middle. Dunstan was good. Jeremy Cameron kicked four and pulled up well. That was the main thing there. But, gee, they were good with Maxie King. And then he got a bit of a sore abductor.
Yeah, he was sore last week. You wonder whether he should have played. Started really well. But last year's grand final, Richmond wanted chaos versus the Cats' composure. It was the same yesterday. I want to show how this graphic board. So they only took 14 marks Geelong in the first quarter because it was a fast-paced game by St Kilda. Then when they got the game on their terms, they took 28 marks, 19 marks and 30 marks. This is how it looked with the vision. This is how St Kilda kicked the first five goals. It was all fast-paced. Geelong want the game slow. They want it measured. They want it composed. They couldn't get the game on their terms, and the ball was coming in really quickly to Max King, and Henry just wasn't big enough. He was just beaten time and time again in one-on-one situations. Here's another one. Geelong just couldn't get settled in their defence. They all liked to zone off, but they couldn't get back again to get in front of Max King. So that was the first quarter. Watch how the game shifted in the second quarter. So you see Henderson, the game's so slow, you've got a defender who can just drift down, take marks like Henderson does here. It was slow, it was measured, it really frustrated St Kilda, and this is where I reckon St Kilda got it wrong. You have to man up. You can't allow these chip marks. Bradley Hill, what are you doing there? Come up on Joel Selwood, he didn't do it. Then they would launch when they could, deep inside 50, marks like this. This was the sealer. So it was amazing how Chris Scott can get games back on his terms when it wasn't going his way in the
first
quarter.
I think that mark there, the question was, where was the St Kilda ruckman?
Yeah, it's a good point. But what they did was, Membry was getting back behind the play too, but they'd always pick the side that the spares weren't there.
I think you're right, Nathan. The hair is looking really on point,
dark,
isn't it?
Yeah. It looks good.
We'll start touching your hair shortly if you want to go down there.
Don't touch my hair. Don't touch my hair.
It might be red. It's reddish.
No, is there a red in there?
Burgundy.
No, jet black. It is jet black. Kane, your hair looking really good too, and of course we'll get an update on that. Well, he's on the mosh.
It's thick, isn't it?
No, I'm not talking about you as a person. I'm talking about your hair. But Tom Stewart, how detrimental is that going to be to Geelong's chances?
Well, it's big, isn't it? I mean, what a player. He's going to win his third All-Australian, isn't it, this year, and he's not going to be there. So a couple of those examples, and it sort of taps into Lordo's point there with how it has disrupted Geelong's defence. They only had 32 entries, the Saints, and they scored 16 times. That's 50%. From my calculations, Bill, which is a massive number. To be able to be in the game with only 32 entries just goes to show how organised and how key Tom Stewart is. He can play tall, he can play small, he can play as a spare as well. So I think they can still win it without him, but it's going to be really difficult. He's not going to play again this year.
Could be a 1v2 clash if Melbourne beat Adelaide today, Geelong versus Melbourne next week, but not sure Tom Hawkins is guaranteed to be there after this tackle late in the game yesterday against Darryl Joyce. It was it's a tackle that will need to be looked at by the match review office.
Oh, that's all right, isn't it?
He gets
He was subbed out of the game, TJ, as a result of that.
Well,
he came off and didn't come back on, and he's in the tracksuit. But that's been late in the game, and that's what they look at.
Similar to this one.
Same venue earlier in the year. Holman on Duncan. That was initially graded as a holding the ball free kick. He then went to the tribunal, got off, and played the next week. So if he got off that, the Cats will be arguing that there's a precedent there, and as such, Hawkins will play. But it will be looked at. It has to be looked at.
Does anyone think he'll go for that?
No. Borderline.
Well, I think there's a precedent there with that one. They're slightly different, but I'd hate to see Tom Hawkins miss for that.
Big forwards tackling. That's what doesn't happen, Lordo. Hey, this, I like this at quarter time it was yesterday by the Saints. They do this breathing. It's very good for you. And they just all get around, they close their eyes and they breathe properly. Now, it's been a bit testy on this panel. Okay.
It has been. You're not going to go with it.
Yes, we are. I think we all should just put it, join hands. And we all close our eyes and we should breathe, okay? You ready? Come on, Tone, get involved because you're the testy one. Ready? Close your eyes. Breathe in. Out. One more. In.
Are we on at the moment?
Out. Have you got a tag to this?
Where are you going to take this?
I don't know, but Damo's over 05 now, sitting next to you.
Tony. Did Tony do that then?
Yes, I did.
Do you feel better?
No.
Endorphins are about...
No, but in all honesty, why is St Kilda doing that?
Well, I think it works for them. They've got some
person there. They went five goals up to losing the game.
Actually, yeah. Good question.
But isn't this thing that Dusty does? He has the coach that teaches him how to breathe.
In and the Murray.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They need a coach now to teach you how to breathe.
I reckon it should be choice. So some love it, but you shouldn't. Everyone shouldn't have to do that. That's my opinion on that. TJ, the Giants on Friday night was a great win. They are on fire at the moment. They belted Geelong down in Geelong.
Oh, Taranto.
And it's the way they're starting. They've got a good mix of experience. They've got a good mix of youth. Yeah, with no Toby Green, Taranto went forward. He kicked four goals.
Well, he was Toby, wasn't he?
He was Toby Green, yeah. So he's won a best and fairest through a midfield in a grand final year. But they're going really well, Brownie, with the way they are playing their footy.
They are. Richmond have won three of the last four flags and people are wondering what happened to them this year. Where are they at? Is the dynasty over? Let's have a look at some of their defenders. This is the defenders. Boulder's missed eight games, probably their best defender. Vlosten's missed 10 games. Hooley, who is the calming influence, has missed a lot. Broad and Baker. Baker's filling a midfield gap and forward. So that is five of their starting mix. So it exposes young defenders, Mantle and Garthwaite, and it also exposes experienced defenders like it. We saw it in Melbourne in round six and then Geelong in round eight, where they dropped a lot of marks in the defensive end and they kicked eight goals. Into the midfield. He's the best player of the last 20 years, but his numbers are 20% down, Dusty. And would you believe that he's a great kick of the football, Dusty, but he has handballed the ball more this year than he has since his debut year back in 2010. Edwards, Lambert, Pressier missed a lot of football. That's their starting on ball. But the biggest problem has been in their forward structure. Now, in 2017, they brought these guys in, small pace and a lot of pressure. Yeah. These guys, poor form, Castagna's not playing. Rioli, poor form, has been moved to defence. You've got Bolton, who's more midfield time at the moment. Caddy's poor form, not playing. And Lynch, his numbers are better than last year, actually. So the pressure they put on hasn't been there. So in summary, where are they at, the Tigers, as we go to the summary? Pressure rating is 178, the lowest of the last 5 years.
Good.
The clearances, they rank 18th. The contested footy post that clearance, they rank 14th. And the clangers, they've had the most in the competition. So, is it over for the Tigers? I don't think so. When they get a lot of those players back, they still can reload, TJ. Oh.
Reload to what, though? Top four, make the finals?
Make the finals again next year. Yeah. When you get all those players back, I think they're an opportunity again. They've got a lot of players who are over 30, so they've maybe got 1 year, maybe two years left.
Who?
Well, a lot of players are over 30. Bashar Hawley's looking for a new contract at the moment, and I'd give him one. I think they've missed him. His calming influence in that back end, I think he plays on. I think Trent Cotchin plays on over 30. They do have a lot of decisions to make, but those players should be playing next year because it has exposed some young players, and they're not up to it yet.
Okay. Billy?
Well done to the Brisbane Lions, by the way. We're running out of time here.
No, we're not running out of time.
But they had a very nice win over Collingwood by 85 points. Go now, Nath, you're right. Very nice 85 points. And Charlie Cameron was back in town. Look at big Charlie, or little Charlie, around the corner, kicked six goals straight. Danaher kicked three, and McStay kicked three. So 12 goals between the forwards here, which was very, very good. But a good win there. Slowly got the mojo back. Well, what does that mean, that one, Dave?
Wasn't the bike, was it?
No, it wasn't the, or the, what's that song that comes on all the time?
Oh, that narrows it down.
I'll think of it.
It'll come to you soon.
But six goals straight. Well done, Charlie. Good win. They're back. They got their mojo back. They needed to.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Can everyone just tell Nathan he was good at the plasma, please? Because you were good. It was very good.
It was.
Thank you, Tony.
I liked it. Well, what's coming now?
Well, because you came back and you went...
You were giving it to me in the pre-show meeting.
No, that
Let's
was,
be honest.
Well,
was
we good. Just thought if you're going to spend 5 minutes talking about Richmond, you might want to look to the future as opposed to...
Well, people want to know what's happening now, TJ. People
Baby
want to know
shark.
What is happening now, what's happened to them. What, right. Bill?
Baby Shark, remember?
Good
it used
on you,
to
Bill.
Play all the time.
Yeah, good. All right.
Daisy just texted me.
Kane, I don't know what you've got in store for what caught my eye, but hopefully it's going to save us. But as we roll the opener, Billy is going to kick us off with what caught my eye, with thanks to our very good friends... Grab your manshakes.
Manshake.
Thanks to your manshake and also the lady shake. Don't hit me with that.
This caught my eye. The second test, England versus India over there at Lord's. This bloke went to Kmart, bought an Indian cricket shirt, and he walks out onto the ground, and this bloke goes, mate, what are you doing? He goes, I play for India. Look, this is my shirt. Security area is Java 69. He had an Indian shirt on and walked out onto the ground. Well done,
that is good.
We don't condone streaking, but no. Well, that's not streaking.
What is streaking, by the way? Well, when you've got to be nude to be a streaker, or is that a streaker?
You did it in Germany, didn't you?
Yeah. Oh, yes, that was very popular.
Now, Bill, I'm
on YouTube.
I'm venturing into your space here, animal facts. Seagulls are called seagulls because they like the sea, as a rule. But extraordinarily here, this flock of seagulls...
Oh, look at it!
This flock of seagulls didn't want a bar of the sea, Bill.
What's happening?
Now, Brownie, what does that...
Oh, it's been at least a week.
Our fearless leader also doesn't like the sea.
Come on, Tony. You're better than that, Tony.
No, sorry. Just I know that this is the anniversary of its 100th running, that particular clip. But what would you do in that situation if the water was coming up and you were about to wet your shoes?
Or part of the story, yeah, you just let the water run through your shoes. Yeah.
Good stand on the toes, CJ.
How tough you are.
But let's be honest, you're not better than that.
I wouldn't have been standing on a beach in clothes, TJ, like that. I wouldn't have had the shoes on.
Like Hutto.
I was doing a news story.
Yeah. Okay.
You're not better than that. Do you think you owe Zach Butters an apology after last week?
You go there.
Zach Butters from Port Adelaide.
Yes. You go
from Bacchus Marsh.
Yes.
From Darley.
Plays for Port Adelaide.
Why would I owe Zach Butters an apology?
Well, here's some vision that might show you.
Well, you can't go there.
Shame. Oh, no. Yes, Bill.
Butters, Zach. Oh, Zach!
Can we play
Well, I'm only saying what everyone in South Australia wants to say. No, hang on. Can I put that into context?
Yeah, this would be good.
Did that not happen, everybody?
Well, it was on the back of those cheating claims in the quiz.
Well, which are fair.
Kane pushed me. He was grinding my gears to the extent that I don't explode, but that I exploded. As a result,
how did you feel about that, Kane?
Yeah, awful. I haven't slept all week, Brownie.
Well, it is disappointing because you were called a cheat multiple times, and that's been unsubstantiated at the moment. But we've had a look into it during the week, and this is a little bit of a sneak peek of what might be coming up next week. Has TJ got a case to answer?
I think it's quite clear looking at the footage.
Athens, the women's eight.
Gone early. It's got to be Sally Robbins. Lay down, Sally.
Got that early, TJ. I'm worried where this this rundown's been.
I'm not putting up with
I feel
that.
Like you're cheating at the moment.
$5 was really aggressive pre-quiz. He was talking about wanting to Sam Mitchell, Peter Hitchener.
You could forgive me for not liking him.
Why should I dumb myself down to make a hack journo and has-been footballers look better?
Damn it. Absolutely damn it is.
You'll do anything to be number one.
Can I get a lawyer?
Did you cheat at the quiz?
What about that acting? Oh, no. Tony, overacting.
No, that was Charlie Pazina, the former top cop that's sort of investigated some of the most horrendous crimes in memory.
You did get him awfully quick into the quiz on a couple of questions.
Oh,
even before
Nathan,
I asked the question,
Nathan,
you were giving me the answer.
Yes. Nathan, we're going to go down this path again, are we? Because can I tell you, that affected my week, being called a cheat.
Did it?
Absolutely it did. I mean, you dirtied up because Caroline Wilson had a go at you, right?
Yeah,
don't touch Lordo, don't touch any, but, Tony's fair game, and enough is enough.
So
and
you're saying right here and now you have never cheated in the quiz?
Oh,
I did not cheat last week.
Good question, Lordo. Do that acting again. Do that acting. Do that again.
Okay. Okay, now keep laughing, Lordo, because at the top of the show, after ScoMo finished, we caught up with your old schoolmate and your football captain at school, Hoags. What's his real name?
Ben Hogan.
Ben?
Paul.
Ben Hogan, right. So we caught up with Ben Hogan, and when last we met, Ben was telling us, or Hoags was telling us about the time you, presumably in year 12, and you were playing reserves football for Essendon, and you're at the Crowbar on King Street, and you were hooking into the Vodka Cruisers.
But you would have been 18, though, wouldn't you, at the time?
Yeah, I was.
Anyway, Hoags picks up the story now, and this is on your way home.
Time to go. We caught a cab home. You go, got to go to the 7-Eleven. I said, why do you got to go to 7-Eleven? He goes, I've kicked 7 today at Skinner Reserve versus Footscray. I'm a chance to be in the papers. There's going to be a write-up about me. Little to be known, we get there. Page three, not back pages. A star is born. You were that happy. We were high-fiving. It was brilliant. You went back in there, bought a paper for your mum, your dad, Simon, Brad, and your sister, and about 10,000 for the rest of the school. It was brilliant. Lordo, you were born that day.
Oh, star. Is that true?
A bit of mayonnaise on that store. I might have bought a couple, Phil. But we used to have some good nights, Hogs. And his claim to fame is that he was a school captain. It was myself, Scott Lucas and Ben Hogan in, up for selection for captain. And Benny Hogan got it. Mm. Not sure it was the best decision by the coach. But
school will be happy with
it. So I just want to continue on the Lordo theme for a second, because I just want to know and ponder how many goals he would have kicked against him should he have played full back. So Lordo went down to the park during the week. Let's have a look at how it went down. So here's his mate Hilly. Lordo thought he was going to play at full back. So Hilly gets away from him here, pushes off, free kick against, bang, lands on his head, and also probably a report. So there's one goal against. So we go back to the goal squares. We just have slow-mo a couple of weeks. So we'll go back to the goal square here, Bill. So Hilly's 45. He hasn't played footy in 20 years. By his own admission, says he's a little bit more not fit. And we caught up with him during the week, and he had a message for Matthew Lloyd.
Matty Lloyd, one of the great full forwards of the game, but as a fullback, well, he's slow, he's got the turning circle of a truck, he just doesn't want to defend, and quite honestly, he just simply gives up. But anyway, Lordo, you kick straight, that's the main thing, but mate, you've got to stop daydreaming about kicking goals, seriously.
Lordo, your defensive efforts, pretty ordinary, I reckon.
Yes, well, got good mates, haven't I? Also, Hogs and Gilly.
What, they'll throw you under a bus. Yeah,
they will. Brownie, what one for you to finish off? Good, we all want to know where the meat pies have started. And you got a real fascination with pies. And this is where it started. Obviously, this is over the journey with us on the Sunday Footy Show. You just love it. Every ad break, you and TJ just get into it. You've got a table in between you and about four party pies come out each.
The big one.
This one was disgusting. Oh, no. And we're actually wondering, did it start after you retired from football? Did it start or not? Or I don't think it did, because this is way back in 2005 on the Footy Show. You're still playing for Richmond at the time. No wonder you were last round the tan back in your time trials.
This is him in the ad break. Good to see the training is going beautifully there, Brownie. And, you picked up some culinary. Was that a Michelin, three-star Michelin pie that you were eating, was it? Or?
Yeah, the fitness guys will be wrapped with that. So I'll work that up tomorrow morning.
So they paid you millions and millions of dollars of Tigers, and you're serving up that on that breaks of the Footy Show.
Exactly. I was that. That was not great.
Great time.
Is that it?
No, he's just a strange little man.
ScoMo.
You've got to make it funny.
Go back to ScoMo.
No, it was good. That was all right. Good research. And that's why we're on the Man Shakes now. Too many pies. Mm. All right, we're going to take a break. You are watching the Sunday Footy Show. More to come right after this. Welcome back to the Sunday Footy Show. The Sydney Swans just keep on keeping on. They will play finals football, won't make it into the top four. But what this game showed yesterday also is there is a real future for North Melbourne. We'll talk about them in just a moment. Having said that, the Roos will finish wooden spooners.
Yeah, Sydney found a way, TJ. Wasn't at their best, but they looked the dominant side early in the game. Will Haywood kicked 3-3, and he's going to join us, Will. It was a really good response. You've been away for a fair while. Wasn't a great game against the Saints last week, but they've improved a lot, North Melbourne, but you got the job done at Marvel last night.
Yeah, no, it was a good effort by the boys in the end. We got our start right, which has been a focus for us over the last few weeks. They gave us a bit of a scare there, but no, it was good for the boys to get the job done in the end.
Do you feel like teams are starting to go to work on the ball movement of the Swans, which has been a real standout this year? I thought you got slowed down a fair bit by St Kilda, but you got back to some of your best ball movement for a fair portion of last night's game.
Yeah, definitely. The Saints did a really good job of nullifying our influence with our ball movement, and North did the same, especially in that third quarter there where they got on top for a bit. But yeah, as I said, it was just good to get the 4 points.
Well, the last two losses Sydney have had have been against Hawthorn and St Kilda, and both those games I thought your use of the football was pretty poor. It's been your one wood this year so far. Did they do anything different to you, those two sides, to make you use the ball so poorly? It was just an off night, an off day?
Yeah, I think our ball movement sort of reflects on how sort of good our pressure is. If we're sort of hunting the opposition, everything sort of flows from there. And if we have a down night with our pressure, it usually affects the scoreboard.
The introduction of the youth into this team, Will, how important has it been for the overall picture, just to give yourselves the belief that not just the current season is alive, but what lies ahead?
Yeah, the young guys we've got playing at the moment are doing incredible things. We've seen what Errol Gordon's been doing. Braden Campbell came in last night and played a really good role up forward, which was new to him. He's usually off halfback, but yeah, everyone's just been adapting to new roles and the youth we've got is really exciting.
Who's the best of the lot, Will? Who's going to be the best player out of all those names you just mentioned?
Well, it's a tough one. There's a long list. The bloke that's not playing at the moment, Logan McDonald, I think he's going to be an absolute superstar. He's injured at the moment, but it's hard to pick from the bunch. They're all stars.
Yeah, you got Wicks and Rowbottom and Golden and some very good young boys there, a lot of good young talent. And yourself, Will, you've been very good yourself. Kicked a couple of important goals yesterday to seal the deal.
It makes it pretty easy when you've got blokes like Jordan Dawson putting it right out in front of you. So, I'll give credit to those guys. But, this one here, I probably owe Hick a slab of beers for that.
Well, can I just ask you about life on the road? I mean, you've been living out of a suitcase for, I don't know, it'd be coming up to a couple of months now, wouldn't it? I mean, how do you cope with that, and how do you keep your mind space in the right space? What are you doing through the day to actually, keep yourselves occupied? I mean, because you're not at home, you don't have the home comforts there, and I assume you've got your own rooms, you're not sharing with anyone or anything. So give us a snapshot of your day.
Yeah, we've got our own rooms, which is good, so... it's not too bad. I mean, as you said, we've been doing it for a while now, so we're used to it. But it sort of makes training and game day the most exciting part of your week. So it gives you a bit more of an appreciation for footy, I suppose, and just the little things. But we're a really united group, so there's never a dull moment, really.
Will's marking's been a real feature this year, and he's in the votes. Will, you've been on fire this year. Your hands are brilliant. Parker, we haven't mentioned him, 25 disposals, 6 clearances, 8 score involvements. Will's in the votes. Aaron Hall's been having a really, really good year.
Again.
Zerha was good as well. He just missed out. And Tom McCartan, he's a star, one of the best young backmen in the competition.
Good player, young Tom. And well done, Will. You win a lose prize pack, mate. The Callaway soft golf balls there and the Odyssey Tour towel. That is fantastic. Fantastic. The Travis Matthew caps, there's 4 of them for you, mate, to wear around. Also the Aquila shoes and clothing. Oh, they've been great sponsors of the Sunday Footy Show. Kicking goals since 1958. A bar fridge from Bar Fridges Australia. This is why you would just get on the net and order one of those. Yeah. They are magnificent. That's for you, Will. The Rick's Eyewear, of course. You just go to rickseyewear.com.au. And also Platform 28, not open at the minute. Lordo's been waiting there for 2 weeks now at the front, but that will open. That is magnificent. And you get a fire pit thanks to our good friends at AMFX, 100% Australian made. That is a beauty. Well done to Will. He's kicked 28 goals this year. He's going all right, the boy.
Yes. Good on you, Will.
Good player.
Yeah.
Thank you. Just quick beat.
Good on you, Will. Yeah, go on.
Tommy Papley said to say g'day to you, Chompers.
Oh, he likes it too.
Can you tell Tom, I've said it before and I'll say it again, he's nothing but a little smart ass. Right? good on you, Will. Thanks very much. On that note, we're going to take a break on the Sunday Footy Show. Oh, wow. Geez, the hits keep coming. The quiz is next. Lucky old us.
Breathing, sweating, calm.
Oh.
Welcome back to the Sunday Footy Show. It's time for everybody's favourite segment, Brownie's Quiz, brought to you by Sportsbet. Let's get straight into it. You guys play for a home viewer. $500 on the line for that home viewer. Bill.
Lucky you, Kate. Kate Collinson from Geelong. Good on you, Katie.
I'm playing for Eric Quayle from Moorabark in Victoria, Brownie.
I'm playing for another Lloyd, Bill. David Lloyd from Alberton in South Australia.
Related.
It's Kane. What's Kane do? Kane playing?
It's normally you. Yeah,
of course I am.
Josephine Hilly or Hilly, I'm sorry, Josephine, from Morwell in Victoria.
Adrian Zakali, and my buzzer can be Gilly because for my caught my eye, Lordo's mate's name was Gilly. I called him Hilly and they're all laughing at me, so Gilly is the buzzer.
Very good. $500 thanks to Sportsbet. Let's have a look at the leaderboard as it stands so far, and Damo's out to a nice lead ahead of Lordo. Let's test the buzzers quickly, Bill.
Couple of frothy.
Yep.
Oh, come on, pigeonhole. I got a big black shiny car. It's a long one.
We lost one, but we gained thousands.
Yes.
I am an extreme cheapskate.
Yes, you are. And I've kept this under lock and key this week.
Oh,
just
good.
So there's no repeat
cameras
of past weeks alleged.
Yeah, well, mate, after Charlie Bazzini's investigation, you might be the one under lock and key.
Yes, TJ, well done. OK, this is a music quiz, so you should be good at it, and it's right up your alley.
I'm off, Tony.
Question number one. On a dark desert highway.
Couple of frothy cool
hotel
in my hair. Up ahead
no,
in the distance.
No.
It was his buzzer.
Bill?
Hotel California.
Yes, Hotel California from the Eagles.
I got in first.
OK, famous faces question, question number two. Which former Sydney Swan features...
Floyd Capper.
Incorrect. Negative one, Damo. Features in a Beatles song.
Former.
Hey.
I am an extreme cheapskate.
That is correct, TJ. Famous faces. Let's have a look. The way to a good start, Tony. Elvis, we got Pink, we got Me in the Middle, Adele, Robbie Williams,
Adele.
Whitney Houston's over there, Beyonce.
Mm. What would your thinking be with Nathan?
No.
Would he give himself minus three?
It might be the reverse logic.
Yeah.
What about Elvis?
No, I'm going to go Angus.
Oh, yeah?
Angus. He can mute somebody for a question, TJ.
I'm going to mute you, Nathan.
Mm-hmm. You lose a point.
OK, I won't
you
be doing that.
Smart, Alec.
He's won four in a row.
Oh, well, just for that, Matthew, I'll mute you.
Okay, question.
As if a journo's going to turn on a journo.
Question number three. Livin' La Vida Loca was a hit by Spanish singer Ricky Martin. Can you name three Rickies to have played AFL football?
Gilly.
That was Kano. Yes, Kane.
Ricky Olerenshaw.
Ricky O, yes.
Ricky O'Loughlin.
Ricky O'Loughlin.
That's
yes.
The brother of. Yeah.
And Ricky Dyson.
Yeah. That is correct. So you could have gone with Quade, Henderson, Barham, Dyson, Watt, Pettard, Olerenshaw, Jackson, Spargo, Ricky Nixon, McLean, Ricky Graham, Ricky Brown, Ricky Mott and O'Loughlin. Famous faces question, question number four. What was on Ray Charles's mind in the 1960s?
I am an extreme cheapskate.
Georgia.
Negative one for the effort.
Georgia.
Not one, yes. Yeah. Famous faces question. I told you it was right up your rally this week,
yeah,
TJ. You didn't have to cheat this week.
Yeah.
Elvis.
Oh, he's a way to a flyer.
I'm all shook up.
Absolute way to... You'll lose points for that sort of humour.
Yeah, right. That's quite good.
Question number five, Bill. Hawthorn coach Alistair Clarkson often uses which rock legend?
I am an extreme cheapskate.
Kane was in next.
It's a guitar, and I'll say Neil Young.
Incorrect. Negative one.
Damo, shut up. I'll say The Boss.
Yes, what's his name?
Yeah. Bruce Springsteen.
It is. 1 point to Kane. And also, Kane, it says for a bonus point, sing a line of a Bruce Springsteen song. So that would be Born in the USA if you're up for an extra point.
Born in the USA.
I'd give Gilly one off for that.
No, you don't get a point for that. Famous faces question, question number six. The singer of the 1967 hit song Respect shares...
I am an extreme cheapskate.
Aretha Franklin.
Lance Franklin.
Negative one.
That was one point.
Famous faces. Make sure you take one off TJ.
I'll go Robbie Williams.
Robbie Williams. Bad luck, Lordo.
Okay, well, you're out of the equation. Yeah.
Nathan, I need that extra point for making myself look like a fool. And
Kane, no.
Probably.
No, it was it was more like a burp.
TJ, we don't listen to cheats, so you just be quiet.
That's a bit...
Yeah, no, that's actually quite pointed, Kane. You might want to retract that.
Yep. Question number seven. Jimi Hendrix and Prince both have had hit songs featuring the colour of which AFL team?
I am an extreme cheapskate.
Three.
Gilly. Fremantle.
Two. Yes, TJ. Oh. 1 point for TJ's going around. Shut up, Damo. Stop pressing the button.
It doesn't work.
Well, because you don't know the answers, that's why.
You're buzzing in after people are answering. Question eight. Who was the drummer for rock band Nirvana before...
Gilly.
Yes, Kane.
The before has me questioning, but Dave Grohl?
Yes, before founding the band Foo Fighters, David Grohl. Let's go, Kane. Famous faces question.
I just love Whitney Houston.
Whitney Houston. Negative two, Kane.
You still love her, Kane?
Luck. Okay.
You need a bodyguard.
TJ out to a massive start. Okay. I'll play you the start of a song. You must name the song and the artist. Here is the first one. Damo.
It's Bon Jovi. Live on a Prayer.
Yes, yeah. 1 point to Damo.
Well done, Damo. Well done, Damo.
Next song.
Today is going to be Wonderwall.
Yep,
by Oasis.
Certainly was, Lord Oak.
Nice brown.
And here is the last one.
Gilly.
Kano.
That's J-Lo.
Yep.
And Get Loud.
Yes, that'll do, Kane. You get a point for that. Okay, question 10. And it's a bit of a different Who Am I this week. And Lordo, you'll love this one. This is brilliant. I'm going to play you a clip from the 2005 Footy Show segment, Screamers. There's four of them. You must tell me who's singing and which song. Here is the first one. You got
to know when to I am an extreme cheapskate.
Yes, Barry Ram, the gambler.
Here's 1 point to TJ.
Mazza. How good a ball.
Okay. Second one.
Gilly. We lost one, but we gained thousands. Kane got in first.
He did.
Well, that's Kane Pettifer.
And?
I don't know his name, sorry.
Lordo.
We lost one, but we gained thousands.
Yeah, show it again. Show the vision again for Lordo, please. Today is going to be the day that we're going to throw it back to you.
Oh, no. Nice.
Yeah, I don't know him either.
Were they actually trying to be good?
Come on, Kane. Brent Hardigan, his name was.
Yeah. Oh, no. Probably still is.
Okay, here's the third one. Go to the third one.
That's McFarlane.
Yep. Yeah.
What's the song?
Well, Glenn McFarlane from the Herald Sun.
Yeah. Luke.
Yeah. I can't think of the song.
Hard to breathe, Damo.
Oh, yeah.
Hard to breathe. I'll give you one for getting Luke McFarlane, but here is the last one, and I expect you to buzz in quick, Lordo.
Is it everywhere to you? I don't know. By the Michelle Brown, Lisa Lloyd. Yeah.
Lordo. 1 point for Lordo.
On the Footy Show.
Yes.
And TJ. You've taken it out this week.
Well
done, TJ. On the back of a big week last week.
Yes.
There was questions asked, but you bounced back beautifully. Well
Thank
done,
you.
TJ. Who
Thank
did you win the $500?
Yeah, it was Josephine. I don't know if it's Hilly or Hilli from Morwell in Victoria. So, Josephine, we did it.
And you did it legally this week. 9.com.au /brownies quiz for $500. Go to a break, TJ. Well done.
Thank you very much. You are watching the Sunday Footy Show. That was our most favourite segment. Brownies Quiz. Back with more in just a moment. Welcome back to the Sunday Footy Show. It is our great pleasure now to welcome on board a true sporting champion, something that has been bereft on this program for some time. But joining us now via Zoom from quarantine is one of the stars of the Olympics. You don't need to win gold to glitter when it comes to the Olympics, but this man is a rolled gold bronze dozzy. I talk about, of course, the boxer. There he is, Harry Garside. G'day, Harry.
Hey, boys, how you going?
Yeah, good. Yourself?
Yeah, good.
How long before you're out of quarantine?
About 7 or 8 days, so at the midpoint.
Well, you're only halfway through.
Yeah, it's getting pretty bored, mate. I must admit, it's a pretty small room, no fresh air, but is what it is. I've stayed in worse, that's for sure.
All right. Now, Kane Corns is via satellite himself in Adelaide. What, Kane, you're very keen to get involved.
No, I just wanted to find out and ask Harry what the Olympic experience was like. It captivated us all sitting back at home, but to be there with the restrictions, no crowds, what was it like, mate? Give us an insight into it.
I was actually just talking to someone about this morning. I think because of the dynamics of COVID and all the protocol that went into it, it almost made the Australian team, like the dynamic, a much closer team. And we weren't socialising, we weren't allowed to like sort of meet with other countries and stuff like that, we weren't allowed to go to other sports. So we spent a lot more time in the village with the whole Australian team. So to be surrounded by people like Paddy Mills, Jess Fox, Kate Campbell, you mean, these are people that I've looked up to for years, and to be surrounded by them is pretty special.
Harry, congratulations on the bronze medal. You obviously had a wonderful Olympic Games, losing to Cuba's Andy Cruz in the semi-final. But just want to ask you about, yeah, the fight and where to next as well from this point. Now, where do you go? You're only 24 years of age. What is the next fight you're looking for from this point on?
Yeah, it's a question that I've got to ask myself, over the next sort of few months. But it's not just my decision about the next decision. It's my whole team's. And I'll sit down with them, and there's been a few offers put on the table and stuff like that. So I'll sit down with my whole team and discuss that. But the Olympic experience, mate, like sharing the ring with the Cuban, Andy Cruz, he's one of the pound-for-pound best boxers at the moment, if not all time. And it made me look stupid at times, mate. But I had a red hot crack, and that's all we can do as an Aussie. And I gave everything to my preparation, so I'm proud of myself for that. And I showed up in the ring, and I'll never die wondering, mate. I really did try my best, and that's all we can do.
No, we loved you, Harry. It was fantastic. He had a go, mate. Nice little southpaw. He stuck and jab and all that. Now, Harry, you get very bored in quarantine, so you've asked all your fans to send you stuff, some goodies. You put it out there on Insta or whatever it was. So what kind of things have you received there, Harry?
What's that?
I've received a lot of food. I actually took it off because I felt very greedy. But there were some other things I probably won't mention on this show. But I'll leave it up to your imagination. Some of the boys back home, I'm from a country town, they sent me a couple of naughty things, but it kept me occupied, mate, which was good. So I took it down because there was too much stuff was coming in.
Hey, Harry, stepping inside a boxing ring is most people's definition of stepping out of their own comfort zones. You like to do that yourself in your own way. You've gone for 48 hours with not talking. You've ventured down the karaoke path. You've also wanted to do some sessions with ballet as part of this process.
Correct, yeah. For the past 2.5 years, I've been doing one challenge a month that pushes my comfortability and being more comfortable with being uncomfortable. And I've done stuff like no talking, started ballet, as you mentioned, had some really tough conversations, which is probably the hardest one for I feel most males. I had some tough conversations with family members, ex-partners, done numerous other challenges. And each challenge teaches me something new and makes me grow as a person. And then entail will help me grow as an athlete as well. Because I really think being a good person is first and then a good athlete second.
Yeah.
You recently spoke to the Melbourne Footy Club as a group. What did you speak to them about?
Yeah, it was great. It's great that they're supporting Reach. I know Jimmy Steins, who I'm wearing on my chest, he's a great man and he did a lot for me personally. I never met Jim, but through the Reach Foundation, they come into my life when I was about 16, 17, lacking a bit of direction and always had a dream of going to the Olympics and representing Australia at the Olympics. And through the Reach Foundation, I feel they pushed me in the right direction. And the rest is history on the results of my life. But, I'm massive for the work that Reach does. And that's why, I'm trying my best to support Reach as much as I can now because our young people need Reach more than ever. With what's going on in the world.
That's right, and the code's up there. It was up there on the television. We can put it back up there. And, of course, anyone at home now can actually just get their phones up there. We all know how to do QR codes now, and that'll direct you to the appropriate site there and also learn ways that you can actually help. So, Bill?
I just wonder if you got the medal there. There's this QR code right there now. You got the medal there, Harrison?
Of course, mate.
Where is it?
It's not the colour we wanted.
No, it's all right, mate.
But, yeah, it's all right. We'll train harder and hopefully 2024 we can... Australia's never won a gold medal for boxing, so let's hope 2024 we can change that.
Yeah, exactly. So, okay, well, Harry, it's a delight to catch up with you and once you're out of quarantine, feel free to come into the studio and join us in person. That'd be great.
Thanks, Chompers. I appreciate it, mate.
You might take him on, Tony.
Harry, if you weren't a boxer, I'd probably have a crack back. But yeah, maybe I'll put one of those mouth guards in when you do come in. What was that?
It'd be a big one. Yeah, we should have that little spa. It'd be nice.
Yeah, me jump in the ring with Harry Garth. Yeah,
I'd love to see.
We're going to ask Harry about his nails. Is there something behind that?
Ask him.
Harry, what's behind the nails?
Yeah, so the Olympic rings, I copied my mum. She's got similar design. And the thing behind it is, mate, I come from a bit of a country town in Melbourne, and I felt like there was just so much pushing us when we were younger about roles that we had to play. This is what a male does. This is what someone from this area does. And I always just felt different, mate. And I hated that I felt like I had to do what other males were doing or what was pushed on me by society. And I'm just showing by painting my nails that you can be whatever you want to be. You don't have to form to other people's opinions on what your life has to look like. You just have to chase your passion. And that's probably the work that the Reach Foundation has done for me and the outlook that Reach has helped me come to on my life. So I'm grateful on the work that Reach does for young people. And $11 is all we're asking to support Reach. And because it was Jimmy Stein's number and it was Maxie Gorn's number as well. So $11 to support Reach and help young people as well.
Fantastic. All right. Well, as we said, Harry, you're welcome here anytime you like. Maybe on our grand final show.
That'd be great.
Harry might come in. That'd be terrific. All right. But in the meantime, you enjoy the rest of the time in quarantine as much as you can. And for everyone watching, keep sending Harry things in. Good on you, mate.
Thanks, boys.
OK,
thanks,
see you later. Thank you. There he goes. Good fellow.
Maybe really we all spar Harry for 30 seconds or a minute, Damo, you reckon?
Wouldn't have thought so.
Maybe just Damo.
No. Drop him.
You can do it if you want to do it.
I'll do it if you do it.
I won't be doing it.
I'll have a spar.
Because I won't be.
One in all in Damo.
No.
Come on, do it for charity and Reach. And...
No, I'll do that. I'll do that.
No, Billy said he'll have a spar.
I'll get the gear off and jump in the spa.
On that note, we will take a break. You're watching the Sunday Footy Show. Yeah, of course, Lordo's Deep Dive brought to our screens thanks to our very good friends there at Unique Wrought Iron. Go and see Jez and Al and the team. We are in lockdown, but they're always open online, so log on. You can bag yourself a bargain.
TJ, off the back of Messi, Lionel Messi leaving Barcelona for PSG, we thought we'd look at the biggest moves at AFL level of players leaving clubs, and we thought we'd start with the biggest one. It was when we all thought Lance Franklin would leave the Hawthorn Football Club for the GWS, and he ended up at the Sydney Swans. Here is one of Buddy's first interviews.
Buddy Franklin shocked the football world. This afternoon, he broke his silence.
Mate, off to Sydney, fantastic deal.
Oh, it's obviously... unbelievable experience, like getting a 9-year contract up in Sydney, and something I'm looking forward to.
Stunning all with his decision to join Sydney following months of speculation that he was off to the Giants. Franklin's denying claims the Swans deal was a year in the making.
Yeah, I only found out the last couple of weeks, literally, that Swans were interested. It was a massive decision to sit back and tell your teammates, guys you play a lot of football with, yeah, it was heartbreaking.
You obviously believe your body can play to 35?
35, yeah, hopefully. Hopefully if John plays me deep, I reckon I can go to about 42, I reckon.
So 42. I laughed at that. 9 years, 35. Yeah. I thought, there's no way he's going to get through this, and yet they may extend him even further, which was amazing. But it did get pretty bitter, and Mike Fitzpatrick, the AFL chairman at the time, he had these things to say about the deal on open mic.
I was unhappy only in that I had been probably the last defender of Collar. And so I felt...
That's the cost of living allowance.
Cost of living allowance.
That the Swans had.
And I was reliably told for many years that this was simply to look after the journeymen and the young players. But, you know, increasingly became obvious with both the Tippett acquisition and then Buddy that wasn't the case. And I was very disappointed in that. They ended up with the best two players in 2 years in a row that were on the market. So I felt I had to have a discussion with them.
So the Giants missed out on that all-time great. They also missed out on another all-time great in Dustin Martin when they had a massive crack at him in 2013. And This is the Footy Show cameras capturing Dusty leaving Melbourne Airport, then getting to Sydney and going to the GWS facility. So Stephen Silvani there, Dave Matthews in the orange vest, the chief executive officer.
Ralph.
Graham Allen still working for the club at that time. Ralph Carr was his manager, taking him through. And it looked likely, given that the Tigers had put out a statement on the same day or the same period of time, that they were exploring all options and possibilities, that he may be out the door, but ended up coming back, staying at a lesser rate than he initially wanted. But the rest, as they say, is history. Three Norm Smith medals later, and he's effectively a Tiger for life.
One star who left GWS, of course, Adam Treloar, and it was very much a toss-up between Richmond and Collingwood, but in the end, Treloar thought that Collingwood had a better chance of a premiership than Richmond. In fact, he said so in a media conference and was made to pay for telling the truth, basically, which didn't necessarily turn out to be the truth, as Richmond fans will tell you. But this is when they first met, Richmond and Collingwood. Now, just to set it up, Lordo, so what happened was that Cochin was getting stuck into Adam Treloar by saying, you picked the wrong club, and then after Collingwood kicked the winning goal through Grundy, Treloar said to him, mate, you spoke too soon.
It was huge, absolutely huge at the time. And obviously, Adam Treloar made the comment that they have a better list, as you just touched on previous, and he never, ever lived that down and missed out on a few flags, obviously.
Mm. OK, sorry, I thought we were going to Kane there. But arguably, the greatest player we've seen is Wayne Carey, along with Lee Matthews. So it was massive news when he decided he was going to leave North Melbourne and he was at to Adelaide. And here is Wayne Carey at the airport heading off to Adelaide. He announces he's moved to Adelaide. It's a nice stripy shirt. Look at that. Just a three-quarter pants from Duck.
Well, he's just getting into the Adelaide fashion, I think.
But it was massive news, wasn't it, Damo?
Oh, it's huge, and to think that he could get back. And he actually was playing really well in that second season that he was there before he had that incident with the goal post or the point post,
yes,
and never,
yeah,
ever played again. They were mounting something pretty special with him playing a role in that particular
season. So he never played after crashing into the...
Never played again after that one.
Is that right? Yeah.
He was playing some pretty good footy at that stage. This is his first game against North Melbourne, and he was very happy, Duck, and there was a moment here where he come towards Stevens, he goes down, then Archer comes in and throws around us, and then Duck gets up and Archer go at it again, and this was big boy stuff, wasn't it?
It was, and this was a moment you thought, could it explode? Duck had the last laugh in this game, Brownie, where the Crows actually won this game quite easily, but didn't probably get what he wanted out of the Crows due to an injury, wasn't it?
Due to injury, yeah.
That game, the atmosphere that night at Telstra Dome, I think it was, was just electric. Like, the Adelaide bus pulled up. It could not have got any closer to the door of the change rooms, you know, just to protect Carey and everything. It was enormous that night.
Quite ironic that Lee Colbert was his first opponent there.
Exactly right, because in 1999, he was captain of the Geelong Footy Club and he wanted out. He left the Cats, which was just unbelievable. Also, Gary Ayres, I reckon, the day before, so the Geelong lost their coach and their captain in about 2 or 3 days, and he had to go to the best and fairest, and this is Colby at the best and fairest for the Cats.
Out of contract captain Lee Colbert last night walking out on the club, fearing for its survival. Chief Executive Brian Cook emerged from his office at the ground, now being referred to as Shell Shock Stadium.
We can afford to lose some battles, but I felt the Lee Colbert issue was one we didn't want to lose. But that's life, and we'll get on with life.
Also tested, the courage of Lee Colbert, the former Cat captain, back at the club for the Best and Fairest Award, a chance to explain his walkout to join the Kangaroos.
Because I've made a difficult decision regarding my football future, I apologise to those people who feel that I've let them down.
After 7 years at the club, Colbert was ready for the mixed reception. The farewell helped by encouraging words from another on-field leader, Gary Hocking.
They may not understand, mate, but they should respect your decision, and I just hope that's... I can leave you with that.
Good effort. Good effort.
That's good vision, absolutely.
Isn't it, Bill? Really good effort to go to the best and fairest when he was
leaving. But he's a quality person, isn't
great
he, Lee
bloke.
Colbert?
Yeah. Don't find a better bloke than Lee Colbert.
He's had an interesting career post-footy too with his airline...
He's a pilot licence, pilot.
Now he's got a McDonald's.
A McDonald's?
Yes, up in Mildura. So if you're up in Mildura, just drive in, and Colby's got to work. He's working there.
I know.
In the drive-through.
Kane's about to finish off for us, but it would have been the first captain probably for a long time in modern game to leave a club. So it was just huge.
Yeah.
Was Chris Judd captain when he left West Coast?
Yes, he was. He was. And he hadn't got to captain the team per se because he did the knee in the year that he was made captain and then walked out at the end of it.
So. Didn't like the senior players there at the time.
Yeah, there's an issue going on with them. Yeah.
Another one at Geelong.
Players? Me.
Another one at Geelong was this one, was Gary Ablett leaving, of course, going to the Gold Coast 2010. There was all sorts of stories about this, Damo. You'd remember the media hysterics around it. Gold Coast had their front page paper with petitions. Then, as we look to what Geelong did in their town with the Geelong Advertiser, they called it the Ablett Tiser. I'm not sure if we've got a cutaway of that, Bill, but there it is there. That was what it was, a letter to Gary Ablett to stay front page. But, of course, he went up there for an offer that you couldn't refuse. I reckon it's the only time the Gold Coast has been really relevant, haven't they? When Gary was there playing the footy that he played up there.
Jeez.
Since is that an inaccurate statement?
It's a decent drive-by.
Well, and it's true, TJ. When's the last time, other than him being there, have we really focused on the Gold Coast?
Carmichael Hunt.
And he fell out, didn't he, to Damo and Bill, with Bomber Thompson? Was that the story?
Yeah, it was. They didn't talk for a while. Yeah.
And he felt that Bomber led him down the wrong path in terms of Bomber then left the club himself in the same period of time when he was questioning him both privately and publicly about committing and recommitting.
Fascinating deep dive, Lordo. And, of course, one that we didn't get to, which was before my time even, is when Ron Barassi left Carlton to go to Melbourne. And to this day, people who remember that say the biggest shock in terms of a player switching from club to club.
He left Melbourne. Carlton.
Yeah, what did I say?
It was huge, wasn't it?
And we just didn't quite have time for Nath's decision to leave the Dogs for Richmond.
Well, that was money.
I think we were talking about footy stars.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
All right, we'll take a break. You are watching the Sunday. You with us? Oh, you're in your down period. Yeah. Right, okay. All right, you're watching the Sunday Footy Show. More in just a moment. Welcome back. You're watching the Sunday Footy Show. Nath, tell us about Hawthorn and the Bulldogs.
Hawthorn and the Bulldogs are very good yesterday. The Hawks down in Tasmania, and they were very good against the Bulldogs.
They were, but I rather have a look at the Saints and Geelong.
Oh,
let me tell you,
right.
At GMHBA Stadium, and the Cats won by 14 points in the end. Jeremy Cameron 4, good to see him. Hawkins 3. Membry was good. Max King was marking everything. He was on fire early. He was very, very good. Then hurt his groin.
Sorry, Nath.
Hey, big Maxie here. Kicking goals from that pocket, which was just unbelievable. As Kane said earlier, only went inside 50 32 times and actually kicked 11 goals, 5. So they were pretty good. They were efficient when they got inside. They were good early. And the Cats slowly crawled back, ended up winning by 14 points on the back of Paddy Dangerfield doing some good work in the midfield.
Jack Steele had 21 for half-time, only 9 more for the rest of the game.
Cam Guthrie, I think, ran a bit with him.
Yeah, they tried O'Connor for a period. Yeah. They had to push O'Connor back because no Tui and also Tom Stewart. But as I said, Bill, I reckon it's the way they possessed the ball. It just took a lot of steam and energy out of the St Kilda side. Are you concerned about them, Bill?
Yeah, I am. They've got to get the mojo back. There's no doubt about that. They're a bit like the Western Bulldogs. They just got to get going and more attacking. Dangerfield was outstanding. Menengola was very good. Cam Guthrie, good. And well done to Jack Steele, who was on fire early. But a good win, but you'd like to see a bit more out of the Cats if they're going to win a couple of finals, Tone.
Sorry, Nath, I was a page ahead of myself there. So I was wondering why a St Kilda logo was behind you doing the Hawth Melbourne Footscray game. Hey, Billy's standing by now with the list.
Oh, well, the game was stopped, of course, during the week. When was that? Last Monday? The last quarter went for an hour because of... Thunder and lightning it was. It was very, very frightening. Everyone was a bit worried about that. So today, on the back of that, it's when games have been stopped.
Yeah.
For a different reason.
You got to get the... Yeah.
So number 5, here we go. What about this? It was a head count. Remember this? Guy McKenna called for a head count here. He thought there was too many players on the ground. Nathan Burke's not sure what's going on. The umpires go along, they count them. And guess what? There was 18 each side, so nothing. We play on, boys. Keep going. What do we do that for? Number 4. Now, look at this one here. They did a lap of honour over at Footy Park, and the bloody car broke down. It stopped, so they had to push it onto the truck and get rid of it. Look at a terrible old car, anyway. I'm not sure it would have made a lap.
They just sponsored Bill.
Number 3, the scoreboard, of course. About this? When the scoreboard at the MCG went up, that was unbelievable there. And smoke-free. Good advertising. But that went up. That was interesting. Number 2, the swarm of bees. Sri Lanka taking on South Africa. And look at the bees. They were everywhere. The boys just hit the ground. That stopped the game for a while.
There was a real buzz around the ground.
Good one, Kane. This bloke said, come on, boys, what are you doing? They're gone. Let's go. He caught a couple. And number one. Oh, now, Matthew Lloyd, you're in the grandstand this night when the lights went out at Waverley.
I played in the twos just beforehand. We all could not believe what went on. And the Bombers got through about 2.5 quarters, Bill.
Yes.
And then we came back on a Tuesday night and played the Saints.
And so you didn't play. You thought you were going to play.
I thought I'd fractured my thumb in the twos that game beforehand. So
it was eight changes. They knocked off the point players.
And you always run into some bloke reckons he's got in his lounge room at home.
Yeah. They came back for 16 minutes, didn't they?
Was that what it was?
Yeah, 16 minutes. And I think they dirtied up because Essendon brought back James Hurd, who hadn't played in the original.
You could do what you want. I reckon we made about seven to eight changes
really?
In that game.
Yeah.
A lot of the young blokes.
One of the inclusions?
He might have been, yeah. I know a lot of young kids as well. Yeah.
Okay, we're going to take a break. When we come back, Nathan's going to tell us about the Bulldogs and Hawthorn, aren't you?
I was a bit surprised before waking up these days. Welcome back to the Sunday Footy Show. It was Launceston yesterday. The Hawks won their third game in a row against the Bulldogs. And I don't know why we're crossing the T's all the time, because I'm the host here. McRae had 32. Bontempelli wasn't his usual effective self with 31, but still got it. Daniel Howe, career best 34 disposals, looking for a new contract. And the Hawks started this game really well. And you look at the stats at the end of the game, you maybe thought that the Hawks could have fluked to win, but it wasn't the case. They were plus 17 in contested possessions, plus 16 in inside 50s. Just shows you the dominance of what they had. Now, the Dogs got in front in the second term. They kicked 3 goals in 3 minutes. It got back to 10 points in front. And you thought, OK, status quo has been restored here. And you thought the Dogs would go on with it. But then the Hawks started to win the football against the coalface. They started to kick goals like that one. They started to ride their own luck. But they had the best players on the ground. Wingard, I think this is his best he's played football since he left Port Adelaide. He was a star in his early days. But since he's gone to Hawthorn, this is his most consistent patch. 26 disposals. For Wingard,
at least the month of his form, hasn't it? It's been really good.
And it's coincided with Hawthorn winning those 3 games and drawing another one, Damo. So, look, Hawthorn have got a fair bit to work with next year. Kaczynski kicked 2 goals, didn't have a lot of the football, but the impact he had on this game was profound. That is a big kick in the conditions early in the last quarter. I mean, he's not the best kick in the world, Daniel Howe, but that was a massive kick. And the Hawks, that man, I gave best man on the ground. Wingard again.
2 nines.
24 disposals, starting to play some nice football. And Jonathan Segler, 34 hitouts to 10. And I thought he dominated Tim English.
Wow. Yeah, not bad, Nath. All right, now it's time for our animal fact as Billy Brownless takes us deep into the wild.
Oh, yes, Tony, I love this. And I've got a lovely some vision here of a beautiful white tiger. Have a look at this. But unfortunately, it's not about the beautiful white tiger. It's about... the bloody donkey wants to get in there, and he's there. Have a look at the donkey. It's about me. Look at me, look at me, look at me. He always says that, Lordo. But what it looked like your donkey, Tony, there. But donkeys can live 50 years. Did you know that? And you know what a male donkey is called?
An ass?
No, a jack, and a female is called a jenny. There you go.
A jenny?
A jenny, yeah. There you go. Some facts that you didn't know. Did you like the donkey?
I don't know if it was a beautiful white tiger. It looked like it had been a pretty good paddock, that one.
Mind you, it might have been more beautiful had it not been in a cage.
Oh, thank you, Tom. Anyway, it was about the donkey. Yeah.
I thought it was good, Bill.
Yeah, it was good. It was good. Yeah. It's something to work on for next week.
50 donkeys, yeah.
Yeah. Now, Damo, what's on your agenda?
Let's have a look at the Tasmanian footy issue, TJ. Releasing of the Colin Carter report, 3 options, which I think were obvious to some, but there is a lot of research behind this. So, a 19th licence, which seems unlikely, as in an immediate licence, Bill, given the COVID situation. Yes. You've got a relocated Melbourne club option, which has been on the table for
many
years.
They don't want that.
Or a joint venture,
say
Tasmania
that.
And a relocated Melbourne club. Peter Gutwin, the Premier, for those who haven't seen this, just take note of the venom in the voice here when he explains. He's not happy.
The AFL doesn't meet that timeline, and if we can't get to a decision by the end of the year, we will not accept any more excuses. And if that means that AFL content is not in Tasmania next year, then be it on the AFL's head.
Yeah, well, I'm a little bit like their Premier. You know, if you're going to have a Tassie side, then let's get it cracking from scratch. If I was the AFL, I'd just be saying, listen, let's have Tassie in by 2025 or 26, and let's get them started now.
he can speak freely, Clarko, Alistair Clarkson. They're the second of those two faces and voices. Now that he's not going to beat Hawthorn, they've got a contract to play matches in Launceston next year, North Melbourne in Hobart. Those contracts are clearly up for renegotiation as a result of this latest change in policy.
Now, Peter Gutwin, the Tasmanian Premier, he was quite a handy footballer.
A local footballer, hard at it.
Yeah.
Like he's a premier. Yeah, goes hard at it. But they wanted to hear something new. They wanted to hear they got their own side. And if it's in 5 years, so be it. And the state will come together. I know they talk about, you know, fractions and all that. But for a team in the AFL, they will come together. But they want to know when. But you're right, COVID just hasn't helped them.
Now, we spoke to a number of former Tasmanian greats about this story on Friday for Nine News. Peter Hudson.
Great man.
Mm. Right, spoke to him on the phone. Loves the Sunday footy show.
Oh, hello. No,
but who do you reckon his favourite panellist is?
Kane.
Unbelievable, Kane.
No.
Oh, why are you so surprised?
Well, I think everyone watching is at the moment, to be honest. But no, he loves you, Kane. He's a big rap, Peter Hudson, for you.
That is a big thrill from an absolute great, one of the AFL legends. So thank you, Peter.
And Kane, you're...
And also thank you to Royce Hart, who also sort of loves watching the show.
And Kane, your old team going beautifully now. They've got some continuity in the performances of some of their guns who have been injured throughout the course of the year. They will be most likely playing the Friday night game into round 23 to start off the last fixture for the season. It's against the Western Bulldogs, who are going into that game having lost their past two. So that game, you can see they're listed currently as the eighth out of the nine games there, but that will be most likely elevated to the Friday night.
Can I ask you, Kane, I know earlier we spoke about Port, but you thought earlier in the year maybe they're not good enough to win a premiership. Has that changed now from your end or not?
Yeah, it has a little bit, Lord. I just think the early season form. So they've only won two out of their nine games against top eight sides, but they were a long time ago. I just think they're positioned beautifully. I'd be thrilled if I was Ken Hinckley. 16 wins for the year, their most since 2004. That's a marvellous effort with some of the injuries they've had.
Going to be a busy week for Michael Christian at the Match Review Office at the AFL. One of the incidents that will attract his attention today will be Brodie Mychek's hit on Tom Fullerton yesterday. It's one of those ones where, again, in the pace of the game, Bill, he has, though, made a decision to ignore that ball that was above his head at the time.
So everything looks bad in slow motion.
It does, but there is a decision to be made in that split incident.
I'd love to have a look at that in normal motion.
Did he go for the ball, though?
He didn't go for the ball.
Well, you could argue that he did because it was just so instantaneous.
Was that a footy incident?
Similar to Joel Selwood's last week, wasn't it?
So what are you thinking, Kane? Do you think there's a case to answer? Or
no, similar to Selwood, I think. Selwood got a $3,000 fine. Not sure that the force was enough to get him a week. Very, very similar to last week's.
What would you rather, Lordo, the $3,000 fine or a week off?
You'd take the fine, for sure.
Lordo, you'd take a week off. You wouldn't be forking out $3,000,
It happened to me on grand final day. I went in for a bit of a scrap with David Swartz and I was petrified, so I backed my way out and I still got $3,000 fine.
You pay it?
Oh, I had to, yes.
You wouldn't have paid
straight
it.
Out of the match payments, but got a function afterwards.
Who wins, Hodgie?
Oh, it's another joke.
Who's your mate?
No, you weren't.
Hoax.
You got a fun
straight to the crowbar with Hodgie.
Hodgie.
Well, he looked like Hodgie.
All right. OK, we're going to take a break on the Sunday Footy Show. Back to wrap it up right after this.
If you're not feeling right, know that you're not alone. One in five Australians will endure a mental health issue at some stage in their life. And Mosh is there to help. Through Mosh, chat to a trusted psychologist 100% online from the comfort of your own home. Bulk billed counselling sessions are available for Medicare holders. Hit the ground running and head to getmosh.com.au. It's men's health made easy.
Yeah, another Mosh moment there with thanks to our very own Kane Corns. Speaking of which, here he is, making it easy, a Mosh match winner.
Yeah, a couple of match winners for you today, TJs. We look at their numbers as we have been doing over the last few weeks. I'd be interested to see your thoughts on this. They are making it easy, these match winners, because there's a couple of key forwards playing today. Look at the height, very similar games, although one's a bit younger and similar goals. Let's reveal who they are, because big pistol Peter Wright kicks seven straight in one of the most unbelievable performances you've ever seen. And that man, Ben King, is an absolute star. That is thanks to Mosh, Men's Health Made Easy. Seek discreet and clinical treatment for your sexual health. 100% online at getmosh.com.au.
So they call him 2 metre Peter, but he's actually 203.
2.3 metres.
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't quite roll off the tongue.
2.03.
Just a little pickup.
Not 2.3. He's 2.03.
I'm right, Professor Julius Sumner Miller.
Oh, well, you've made a
glass and a half.
That,
yeah.
2.03.
Okay. Well, whatever.
Okay. Get on.
So he's not 2 metre, Peter.
He's still 2 metres.
But he's a
plus a bit.
Can we move on now to? Do you want to have a look at some Brisbane highlights?
Well, Kane does.
Port Carlton.
I thought we were going to look at Port Adelaide and Carlton because the Port fans wanted some love, TJ. Dixon hadn't touched the ball at the 45-minute mark of the game. Halfway through the second quarter, Wiedering did a good job. He ended up with four, amazingly. Port Adelaide flicked the switch late in that second term and piled on 19-0. A pretty solid performance. And where to next for Carlton? We'll wait and see. There's the vote. Alier, second best on ground for the second week in a row. He was amazing. Byrne Jones was an All-Australian last year. He's had a poor year, but was great yesterday. Boak and my boy Connor Rosie was very, very good.
Now to Brisbane, Connor.
Yeah, what a smashing it was. Collingwood were close early on and then they just got blown away, particularly late in that second quarter and then after half-time. It was just a massacre. 6 goals to Cameron, 3 got Danaher played a brilliant game, I thought. Lockie Neal, 31, McClosey's 30, Lyons, 29. Kano, these are your votes.
Yeah, Dane Zorko was terrific. Cameron kicked 6, so he has to get in there. Massive game. McCluggage and Bailey, look, could have been anyone. Their midfield was just enormous last night.
All Australian, Zach Barley.
Yep, I reckon. Half forward.
He's got all Australian. Zach Barley's had a really good year.
Mm. Toby Green should make it.
Yes.
Yes, he
should. Yeah. Righto, a bit of padding till we go.
No. I'm just today's games, of course. The round's not over yet, so let's take a look.
Here is Melbourne and Adelaide. It's by how far you'd think with the way Melbourne are playing.
You'd think so, wouldn't you? And then you'd think that they would win that and go back to the top of the ladder with one round to go, and then that sets up their big match next week against Geelong, which could be a 1v2 slot.
Forward structure worked okay last week, didn't it? Jackson was good. Yeah. Ben Brown's been very good as well. He's hit some form, so they'd be happy with that. Leading in September, they should win this game.
And the next game, Gold Coast and the Essendon Footy Club. I'm interested in Peter Wright. You kick 7 1 week. How far has he come? What does he back up with? Don't expect him to kick 7.
Against the club that obviously made the decision on him to move him out for reasons that it will still justify and validate.
2.03, Peter.
Yep.
McGrath back too.
McGrath back, yeah. They should win well, the Bombers, you think?
You should win that one.
And the Derby.
The Derby over there. Mm-hmm. Who would win this one? Both have been poor, haven't they? And West Coast certainly have been. But you think they've won the last 11. Of these games.
Well, they're going to have to win one of the remaining two just to book absolutely with certainty a final spot. So I think that would be enough. Yeah. But having said that, their last 7 weeks have been relatively ordinary, Bernie.
West Coast just for me.
Yeah, no Andrew Brayshaw, no Shannon Hearn, but I think... Yeah,
and Chera might be laid out as well. Okay. Maybe be doing a fitness test, maybe. So if Chera goes out...
He's not Cherry, right?
No, he's not Bill.
And Damo, would you expect when we see a near full house there today that would be a sign of things to come for September, regardless of whether they're West Australian teams or not?
Yeah, it's just they're going to have to pitch for it. They're going to have to convince the AFL that it's the right thing to do. They're going to have to stump up some cash as part of that overall pitch. And then, obviously...
How much cash?
It's hard to put a figure on it, Brownie.
But the AFL might not be in a position to actually be demanding money, surely.
Yeah, well, they've got to recoup some of the about 50 or 60 million they've lost on a budgetary sense with the past 10 weeks to 12 weeks of losing $5 million a week just in order to get these teams...
How much they lost?
50 or 60 in terms of budgetary situation. Mm. It's $5 million a week, Bill, for a period of time.
All right, a lot to play out in the next 7 days, that's for sure. Now, don't forget, next Sunday on the Sunday Footy Show, we're going to put to rest once and for all those scurrilous claims of me cheating, driven by Kane, mostly. Yes. We brought in former top cop, Chief Investigator Charlie Bezina through the week, who has carried out a fair dinkum investigation. Here's a taste of what will happen next week.
Has TJ got a case to answer?
I think it's quite clear looking at the footage.
Athens, the women's 8.
Gone early.
It's got to be Sally Robbins. Lay down, Sally.
Got that early, TJ. I'm worried where this rundown's been.
I'm not putting up with that.
I feel like you're cheating at the moment.
$5 was really aggressive pre-quiz. He was talking about wanting to Sam Mitchell, Peter Hitcher.
You could forgive me for not liking him.
Why should I dumb myself down to make a hack journo and has-been footballers look better?
Damn, absolutely damn it is.
You'll do anything to be number one.
Can I get a lawyer?
Did you cheat at the quiz?
Great acting.
Why are you calling him a hack journo?
He's a very good journo.
So you're not denying you're a has-been footballer?
Exactly. But he's not a hack journo. He's a very good journalist. I think from one journalist, you did actually go to school.
And I'd have fitted you in the investigation. Yeah. If I'd have known what you said about me, I would have not have done that. I would have told the truth.
Mm. And what's the truth, Damien?
That the allegations were worth exploring.
Mm. He's a good
journo. Right, okay, thank you. Anyway, that's all coming up next week. And Kane, don't think I didn't notice your little quip there about you don't like me.
No, that was in relation to something else.
Oh. Well, you either like me or you don't, Kane.
That was another person I've had a run-in with.
Oh, is it? Oh, gee,
I just love how Bill explains the Kerry Potthast one. What happened?
No, you hadn't even answered. Bang!
Haven't even opened
Kerry Potthast. No, that was cheating.
Name another Australian female duo from the Sydney Olympics. Okay, well, it's been investigated and we'll get the outcome of that next week.
You're the fastest animal in the jungle. A cheater.
Bill, say it. Come here.
Say that again.
Say it here.
Say that again.
No, I've got to go. Don't worry about it. I've got to go.